Welcome back students to the video lecture series. I am Adil Mansoori from Civil Engineering Department of LG Institute of Engineering and Technology. So in this video we will study the basics of the environmental engineering. So environmental engineering has been divided into four different parts. So the first part includes water supply engineering. The second part includes wastewater engineering. The third part includes solid waste management, and the fourth part includes pollution and its control. Okay, so let us start with the first one, that is the water supply engineering. So let us start with the background. Okay, so you all are aware with the firm known as the United Nations, right? So the United Nations is an intergovernmental organization that aims to maintain international peace and security, develop friendly relations among the different nations, and achieve international cooperation and be a center of harmonizing the actions of the different nations, right? So in the year 2010, the United Nations coined the term right to water. Okay, so according to the right to water, every human being on the surface of the earth is entitled to obtain sufficient, safe, acceptable, physically accessible, affordable water for personal and domestic usage, right? So in India, the right to water has been incorporated under right to live, right? So talking about the classification of water on the surface of the earth, out of the 100% water available, 97% water is available as salty water, that is the water available in oceans, and only 3% of water is available as fresh water. Further classifying the fresh water, then out of the 3%, 70% of the water is located on ice caps and glaciers, while 29% of water is available as groundwater. Just 1% of water is easily accessible water, right? So this 1% of easily accessible water, out of that, 52% of water is available in lakes, 38% of water is available as soil moisture, 1% of water is available as water vapor, and 1% of water is available in living organisms, that is in human beings, plants, animals, microorganisms, and so on, and only 1% of water is available as freshly accessible river water. Okay, so you can imagine the extent of availability of fresh water on the surface of the earth. Okay, so the picture shows the industries, right? As you all know that human beings are constantly looking up for the different opportunities, right? As a result, urbanization takes place, or industrialization takes place, or even the population explosion, right? So if I talk about the natural resources, then for the past few decades, human beings have been exploiting the natural resources, right? The human being, as a greedy animal, have been using the natural resources haphazardly without knowing the value of it, right? So as a result, even the water has been used without any limits, right? So being a responsible citizen, and in order to prevent the climate being deteriorated, right, we should use various natural resources judiciously, right? And hence water is no exception. So I can say that water is the source of life, right? Let us now have a look at some of the shocking facts given by the United Nations. So, United Nations says that 785 million people remain even without the basic drinking water in the year 2017. Okay, you can imagine the extent of scarcity of water, right? Then, United Nations says that 2 billion people live in those countries where the countries are experiencing high water scarcity. Okay, looking further, 2 out of 5 people across the globe don't have even the hand washing basic facilities with soap and water. Okay, then by 2030, 700 million people would be displaced by intense water scarcity, right? Means they will be displaced from their original location to any other location where the water is available. Okay, talking about the healthcare facilities, then 1 out of 4 healthcare facilities worldwide lack even basic drinking facilities for their patients, right? So these are the some of the shocking facts that have come up in the recent years. So let us now talk about the hydrological cycle. So as we all know that during the daytime, in presence of sunlight, right, the surface water gets evaporated. When the vapors rises up, they form clouds. The clouds move along with the wind. And when there is a temperature difference, then condensation takes place, and as a result, precipitation occurs, right? And this precipitation, out of this precipitation, a certain part of water goes as runoff into the surface sources, and certain part of water percolates inside the earth's surface. Okay, students, so let us now start with the next topic, that is the components of water supply scheme. So the components of water supply scheme includes 4 parts, that is the collection work, transmission work, purification work, that is the water treatment plant, and the distribution work. Okay, so collection works are meant for the development of the surface water or groundwater resources. For major cities or where water requirements are large, water is collected from surface sources, that is mainly a river or a stream, right? And if the river is perennial, then a direct intake structure is constructed on the river banks. And if the river is not perennial, then a dam can be built across the river, and water is stored in the reservoir. Then later, when water is needed, then it can be withdrawn as per our needs. Okay, thus collection work therefore consists of a storage or diversion work and an intake structure. Okay, so next is the transmission work. So when collection works are far away from the city where water is to be supplied, then water is usually conveyed to the city through the transmission work. Right, so depending upon the topography of the area between the two sites, the transmission work may be in the form of pipes, canals, or aqueducts. For simply gravity flow, canals are generally used, but for uneven topography, pumping may have to be resorted to. Okay, that is, pumping is the best option, right? Then the third one is the purification work, that is the water treatment plant, right? So whenever the water has been extracted from different sources, then it may contain different kinds of impurities. For example, physical, chemical, or biological, right? That is, the floating particles are there, or even the dead bodies of animals, even the barks of the trees, right? Then there are total dissolved solids, alkalinity, right? So all these parameters needed to be checked, right? So we go for the purification work, right? Purification of the water. Next is the distribution work. So after the water has been purified properly, and it can be easily conveyed or supplied to the community, right? So that is known as the distribution work. So on the screen you can see the layout of the water supply scheme, right? So here you can see the river, right? And on the river we are constructing a dam. So on the upstream side of the dam, the reservoir will be constructed, okay? So from the reservoir the water can be withdrawn as per our needs, right? So this is known as the collection work, right? Collection work. Second one is the conveyance work, right? So that is, here they have kept a pump, right? They have kept a pump, and this is the conveyance work. Right, so in conveyance work there will be some pumps or even valves, right, or even the pipelines, okay? Then third one is the purification work, right? So in case of purification work, the water is treated using different treatment units, right, and from there it is supplied to the community using the distribution work, right? So here you can see this is the pump house, right? And here you can say it is the overhead reservoir. So overhead reservoir is the reservoir which is located in a particular area, and from that reservoir the water is distributed as and when required, okay? So next is sources of water. So the main source of water has been considered as rainfall, right? And when the precipitation occurs, certain portion of rainfall is taken as runoff, right? And it goes into different surface sources as well as the ground sources, right? So talking about the surface sources, lakes, ponds, rivers, storage reservoirs, canals and streams are considered to be the surface sources. And if I talk about the ground sources, then springs, infiltration galleries and wells are considered to be the ground sources, okay? So these are the different sources of water which are available on the surface of the earth, clear? Let us now move ahead and talk about the water demands. So there are basically six types of water demands. First one is known as the domestic water demand. Second one is known as the industrial water demand. The third one is known as the institution and commercial demand. Fourth one is known as the demand for public usage. And fifth one is known as the fire demand. And last one is considered to be the losses and wastes, right? So these are the different types of demand which are usually taken into consideration before designing the water supply scheme, okay? Let us start with the first one, that is the domestic water demand. So water required in the houses for drinking purpose, bathing purpose, cooking purpose or washing purpose, then it is known as the domestic water requirement. This mainly depends on the habits, social status, climatic condition, and customs of the people. As per Indian Standard Code 1172-1993, under normal conditions, the domestic consumption of water in India is about 135 liters per day per capita. Right? It means per person 135 liters is required. Next is, let us have a look at the classification of domestic water requirements. That is, in case of drinking, 5 liters of water is required. For cooking, 5 liters. Bathing, 55 liters. Washing of clothes, 20 liters. Utensils washing, 10 liters. House cleaning, 10 liters. Washing of water closet, 30 liters. So this sums up to 135 liters. So this is the general classification of the 135 liters of water required per day by for each person. Okay. Talking about the industrial water demands, the water required in the industries mainly depend on the type of industry which are existing in the city. Okay. So the water required by factories such as paper mills, cloth mills, cotton mills, breweries, sugar refineries, etc. come under industrial usage. Okay. The quantity of water demand for industrial purpose is around 20 to 25% of the total demand of the entire city. Right. So whatever the quantity of water is estimated for the supply to the entire city, out of that 20 to 25% of the water is considered for the industrial supply. Next is institutional and commercial demands. So universities, office buildings, warehouses, stores, hotels, shopping centers, health centers, schools, temples, cinema houses, railways, and bus stations are considered as institutional and commercial buildings, and the water required by those places are considered as institutional and commercial demands. Okay. Next is demand for public usage. So, can you guess? Yes, it is for the watering of plants, and then it is the public parks. So the water required by the plants and the water required by the people while going for a brisk walk in the morning or for recreational purpose in the evening, then at that particular point of time the water required is considered as demand for public usage. Okay. Apart from that, the fountains which are present in the public places, right, the water requirement is also considered. And lastly is the water required for washing of the roads, right. So these are the different types of demands for public usage. Okay. So nominal amount not exceeding 5% of the total requirement is considered for the public usage, and approximately 10 liters per capita per day is taken into consideration while calculating the total quantity of water required by the entire city. Lastly, the public parks require 1.4 liters of water per square meter per day. Roads watering required 1 to 1.5 liters per square meter per day, and sewer cleaning requires 4.5 liters per head per day. Okay, so this was about demand for public usage. Let us now start with the next one, that is the fire demand. So as you can see from the picture that whenever the fire occurs, right, the consumption of water is extensive, right? It is in huge quantity. Though the frequency of fire is quite less, but the amount of water which is required for dousing the fire is beyond the limit, right? So total three formulae are there in order to find out the fire demand. The first one is known as the Quisling's formula, which states that Q equals to 3182 under root of P. Then it's the Freeman's formula, where Q equals to 1135 into P by 5 plus 10, and National Boards of Fire Underwriters formula, where Q equals to 4360 T raised to 0.275 upon small t plus 12 raised to 0.757. Okay, so Q is the discharge in liters per minute, T is the duration of fires in minutes, capital T stands for frequency of fire in years, and P stands for population, right? So this is regarding the fire demand. Let us now move towards the next topic, that is the water required to compensate thefts and losses. So as you can see, this is the picture showing that water is being distributed and the joints are not watertight. As a result, water is lost, right? And it is due to leakages due to bad plumbing, right? Next one, that is the unauthorized connection. So usually people tend to connect the water line of their houses to the municipal water line without any kinds of authorization, right? So that has to be also taken into consideration while designing the water supply schemes. Okay, so best water works across the world, right, and is entitled for 15% of the water being lost in thefts and other losses. Okay, so that's all for today's video. We will be discussing some new topics in the next video.